doesn't matter how many times I clean the lens, I still get this solid gold light flare going on. So, yeah, I finally got through that thing. Actually, I finished it a couple days ago. And, you know, the problem with these things right away is, like, why are they even made? Like, what's the point of them? I know there's some kind of interest and maybe licensing. I mean, that's really all it is, probably, because once the show premiered, they launched this whole wave of merchandising, all based on, not on the show, but on, like, the original stuff, you know, the original band. And so it has probably something to do with that, because I can't understand, it's not like an artistic endeavor it's not an artistic endeavor in the origins of it, you don't do it in the beginning like that. The idea is conceived, and then maybe they'll get someone on it who will add some kind of artistic flair to it. And it was certainly well done for what it was, you know. It looked good. Probably one of the better looking ones of these kind of films. But the thing is basically they take real people, right, and real circumstances, stories, things that may have happened, and then they basically create really bad fan fiction with it. Like, yeah, we know so-and-so joined the band or whatever at this point, but the conversation and the dialogue is all fantasy, you know, for the most part. And this one kind of is a little more fan fiction-y than some of the other ones that I've seen. The whole Steve Jones, Chrissy Hynde romance was, I've never heard anything about that at all. And because it didn't happen. I think they might have hooked up like once. But there was no romantic love affair. And there's a lot of stuff like that in this movie. I know they have to combine things. Like, sometimes they'll take, you know, and you see this in a lot, even the Queen film did this a lot, where there were three moments that were significant. So they had to get them in there, and they decided for brevity to jam them all into the same night. You know, that's kind of, so this does a lot of that. So it's like, what are you really watching? You know what I mean? It's like, what is the point of all this? It's complete fantasy based on actual people. The actors are good. The set design, before I even talk about the actors, set design was incredible. A lot of these period piece shows or movies, they always, they'll throw a couple t-shirts on people and maybe put a car in the background, CGI some shit, and call it a day. This one was really meticulously done. Some of the houses they were in, just like apartments they were in, like down to the fixtures and like the wallpaper, it was all period accurate. You know, it looks great. It looks really, really good. Whoever did the set design for this did a really good job. So yeah, the actors were all good. Nobody was bad. I thought the guy that played John did the best job. The guy that did Sid got his voice perfectly. Sounded like him. He's like really the only guy in the movie where the lines between reality and fakery were blurred. It almost kind of sometimes, it's almost like you're looking at him. As long as it's at the camera's at a certain length away. The guy that played John did an amazing job too with his inflections and his voice. And, you know, he doesn't really look like him, you know, when you get close to him. But when they had them all on the stage from far away doing the music scenes, looks fantastic. You know, it looks great. The only thing that stuck out is, and this is the same for all the music scenes, I'm like, oh, wow. Yeah, it looks like the Sex Pistols. Who's playing guitar with them? You know, because the guy that played Steve, and sure, he's a good actor. He did a fine job. But there's nothing Steve Jones about that guy at all. It reminded me of, like, that movie, not the movie, the TV show, fuck is that called, Entourage? That guy Vinny Chase, when he would be in a movie, and it was just totally cheesy. He was being movie star guy. The Steve Jones in this was Vinny Chase. It's like, hey, it's the Sex Pistols and some guy. Who's this guy? Steve Jones is not that clear-headed, thoughtful, articulate, sensitive, considerate of others' feelings. They needed some guy to be like the leading man. And they didn't have anyone in that whole crew that could do it. So they just took the Steve Jones spot and just whole cloth made some guy that would take his space. Because that guy, he took me out of it. It's like, wait, who's this supposed to be again? What am I watching again? They might have had his clothes down, but Steve and Paul were the more nondescript members of the group as far as their looks. So it was like, you could always kind of, you could make the image work by getting Sid and Johnny right, and they did. And the guy who played Glenn Matlock was good, too. He kind of looked like him, actually. He was good. Everybody was good. Even the girl that played Chrissy Hine, who was a main character in this for some reason. I know she was around. I know she worked at Sex. You know, I like a lot of Pistols fans. I read a lot of books and watched a lot of documentaries and stuff, but she was, to me, always, like, on the periphery of everything. Like, oh, yeah, she worked here. She was in Masters of the Backside for a little while. That never got off the ground. That had Dave Banyan and Rat Scabies and The Captain all together. Malcolm was trying to put a group together with her. There was this whole pool of musicians around that time. London SS, Mick Jones' band. And Malcolm was kind of doing a mix and match. I'm not going to get into how that whole thing was put together by intelligence agencies because that's from my other videos. But yeah, it was like a pool of musicians. Bernie Rhodes was also involved. Malcolm and Bernie worked for the same people, part of the same clique, and kind of had the same objective there. And so anyway, yeah, the fact they made her a main character, it's like they thought, well, we need a love story. And we need to have one of the guys in the band have a love story to run through the show. And they didn't have anybody. Who? So they kind of made up a Steve Jones character or a completely different character to take his place. And they made up a Chrissy Hine character. They made up these two characters, named them after Steve and Chrissy Hine, and was just like, all right, well, this is it. And it was this really bad, annoying love story that ran through the whole thing. And every time they'd show them together hanging out and her playing guitar with him, like, which, you know, did that ever happen? I doubt it. I don't think so. I know she tried to teach John guitar at one point, but I kept saying to myself, I'm like, if they cut to her here doing Brass and Pocket, I'm gonna fucking throw my phone out the window, because they have to, you know what I mean? Like, that's how these people think that make this shit, you know? They're just soulless, people behind this stuff. They don't know. Yeah, people know that. Put that in there. And they fucking did. Like, the second to last episode. Totally out of sync with time. Time doesn't mean anything. It was a magazine. Time was a magazine for that movie. Like, nothing was in order. And they weren't, like, really even trying to be meticulous on that. And whatever. I mean, I know what it is. It's a goofy fucking... It's... Aside from the cinematography and the money they put into it... Well, no, there was quite a few factors. I was going to say it was basically the Def Leppard BH1 Behind the Music Hysteria movie. In a lot of ways, it was. Just with a little more money and some better actors. Although Anthony Michael Hall as Mutt Lang was pretty good. But, let's see what I can do here. So, yeah, I mean, they're all goofy, these kind of movies. So it's hard to even really judge them. But I felt like I had to watch it, you know? It's just one of those things. I knew it was gonna exist, and I just felt like I should go through it. But I'm telling you, man, the first 5 minutes of the first episode, I was like thinking, I don't know if I can do this, you know, I don't know if I can, I can't, I'm not going to make it through this. Because it's just like, they go through that Wikipedia list of things, and they dramatize it. In this case, it was taken from, a lot of it was taken from Lonely Boy, which, I read that book. The only things about it that really stick with me is his, harrowing childhood growing up in that area where it was just nonsense everywhere in that guy's neighborhood. Like, all really, you know, perverts and stuff there in his neighborhood when he was a kid. And, pretty creepy stuff. And I think they went a little bit far with that. I don't think you need to show that kind of thing. The whole bodies thing I talked about in a different video the other day, where they made Pauline the mystical black person that they need in every one of these shows now in modern entertainment, which is just as bad as the old 80s trope of, well, you can be a drug dealer or you could be a pimp. I mean, it's the same thing. It's just different. Now it's like, you'll be a mystical person. So, yeah, that whole thing was ridiculous. But that it was like that situation over the 6 episodes in every direction. Yeah, there's really not much to say about it. It was just the fact that they tried to recontextualize all the things that they felt might be problematic about the band and its imagery. I mean, this is a group that, in their movie, the bass player, Sid Vicious, wears a swastika for his entire length of his appearances in that movie, except for when he's on stage doing My Way. But a lot of footage of him walking around with it. The band's 6th single, forget what it was, come on, was it the Eddie Cochran song? I forgot. But it was the 2nd single they released after John left. Because they released a whopping 9 singles and 3 records, 1 box set. Between after Bollocks, before 1982, the Sex Pack, which was a box set, More Product, which was an album with interviews, Flogging a Dead Horse, which was outtakes and singles that they'd recorded, and then the Swindle soundtrack, which was, you know, a bunch of crap, really. The only thing good about it was the rehearsal tapes from 76 and parts of what would later become Spunk, the bootleg album. But anyway, I don't want to get away from it. They put out a lot of material after he left. 9 singles. So the 2nd single they'd released, the first one they released after John left was one with Ronnie Biggs on vocals. Ronnie Biggs was one of the guys who did the Great Train Robbery. And that's a whole nother story. I should do like a video charting the awfulness of the 78, 79, 80, 81 years of Sex Pistols, because people have this idea that, you know, they exploded in this blaze of glory and they burned out and didn't fade away. No, it faded away. It faded away. Steve and Paul hung in there for a long time. I think it was like 81. It wasn't until 1981 when they tried to get the professionals going. And even then, they tried to get John to sing for them. And he was like, you fucking crazy? The label they were on tried to get them back together to do the professionals, but he wasn't having it. But yeah, no, they limped along. It just shitting on everything they just achieved back in 76 and 77. So anyway, where the fuck was I going with this? How did we get here? Yeah, so anyway, it doesn't show much. It doesn't show really anything about those years. But Sid wearing the swastika on the single, yeah. They tried to recontextualize all the stuff that would have been problematic now. And they did it really badly. It was like that body situation. Like, they're like, well, we put swastikas on our clothes, but they're pink. Nazis don't like pink. And Vivian Westwood, who they made into this sort of sagely wise, like, all the females are like superheroes, of course, because current day, you know? So, yeah, they're talking about skimpy outfits, where a lot of these outfits don't even have, like, they're see-through, You know, they don't raincoats and with no bras and plastic. She gave this really dumb speech about how it's not for the male gaze. In fact, it was the old "I was just pretending to be retarded" thing. You know, how you act retarded, and then someone says, "Why are you being retarded?" And you're like, "Oh, no, I was just pretending to be retarded." It's like, well, it has the same net result. You look retarded. That's what she did. She's doing, "Well, no, it's not the male gaze. It's turning the male gaze on the male gaze." And you're like, no, it's not. I think maybe a rehabilitation of that brand might have been a impetus for this thing, to get this, or one of the functions of this, the impetus. What the fuck is that? What the hell word? No, that's the right word. One of the reasons to do this was to probably refresh the brand, because like I said, there was an avalanche of shit came out past couple weeks of just merch. And in this day and age, the thought police are out there, and they get bored quick, and they want to go through everybody. So at some point, they're going to get to them, and people can't have that brand damage because it makes money. It pulls in money. So, so I think there might have been some rehabilitation of the brand. Oh, is that the B-Boys? Yeah, the original. So they tried to rehabilitate everything. I mean, they spent the whole episode on bodies, and it was pretty bad. But the whole recontextualizing Vivian's clothes, there was more. There was more stuff. Just anything that would be considered a problem. Now, these guys at the time, they were like IRL shit posters. And they tried to reframe them to meet the tastes of a fucking blue check mark. What a job, huh? What a soul-crushing job. You know? So, as much as there was a lot of love put into it for the people working on it, it's just a pile of crap. It's stupid. The reason they didn't involve John Lydon is because they wouldn't be able to do a lot of the horse shit they do. You know what I mean? They knew cleaning up their brand was part of the, cleaning up their brand was part of the reason for doing this. Hold on. Give me a second. Let me give this guy a tip. I can do a lot with one hand. Thank you, man. I like that guy. There we go. Yeah, I always try to tip the musicians and the artists out here because they add to the area, you know. It's an area where a lot of people take from, especially energetically. There's like a Hoover vacuum over this place for energy. So the people that add to it, whether it's dance or music or whatever they're doing, are valuable. And if you can, you should let them know you appreciate it. But yeah, they wouldn't have been able to get away with some of the stuff they did, especially like with the Pauline thing, because John is like he's a truth artist, because he, due to a childhood illness, he was had meningitis, went into a coma for 3 months. He came out and didn't have, he had complete memory loss. So he had to trust people to not lie to him about who they were and who he was and what his whole deal was. So telling the truth became very important to him. And it just kind of stuck in his craw. So he's very honest. And, you know, and you can say what you want about him. He's not a very likable guy in some cases. But I've never caught the dude in a lie. Like in all my years of fandom, I've never seen him exaggerate a situation. He's brutally frank, you know? And a lot of people aren't going to like you when you're brutally frank, you know? I saw someone recently, I forget what it was, but they were talking about how if everybody likes you, you're not being true to yourself as an individual, something along those lines. Because if everyone likes you, then there's something wrong. You're pandering. You're not being yourself. You're not saying what you mean. He's definitely not like that. So I think he would have been a problem for them. He didn't know anything about it at all. Like, they'd made all the deals for it, and he even picking Danny Boyle. I think casting might have even been. They were doing everything and not telling him about it, because I think they knew that he would have been a air quotes problem for them, because he'd want to do things right, and he would have stopped them from doing all the stuff that they wanted to do. That was the recontextualizing job. He wouldn't want his name on that shit, and all the just made up stuff. It would have driven him crazy. So, you know, being Hollywood scumbags, they kept him out of it because they wanted to do what they wanted to do. And I don't even think they were going to tell him until it was time to get the music cleared for it. Now, they have some kind of setup, a majority rule kind of setup that they've had in place from the beginning, that if the majority decides something, they do it. So I think for a time, they weren't even going to ask him that about using the music. But I think one of the business people, one of the lawyers or someone that was involved with it said, hey, we should probably run it by him just in case, you know? So he got an email, I guess, asking to clear some music. And even at that point, they really didn't explain what it was for. And he had to get back to them through his people saying, well, for what, you know? So he was kept in the dark the entire time. And I believe it's because they wanted to do what they wanted to do. And Steve and Paul are notoriously apathetic about everything. They'll go along with anything. As we've seen, that's just what we've shown. They'll just go, okay, do I get money? Okay, you know, they don't care. I don't even, you know, I'd be surprised if they watch it. John cares about that stuff, you know? So he was going to be a problem for them. So they froze him out of the whole thing. Didn't even let him know what was going on. So he found out that way. So yeah, I you know, he said he was going to watch it, I guess. You know, and as I was watching it, I'm like, man, I hope John never sees this. He came out looking okay. You know, they didn't throw him under the bus. But it's just got to be weird. You know, when, I mean, he's still alive, right? He's watching this thing, having these conversations with people that he might not have had. I mean, it's, like I said, it's real people, real situations, Tumblr tier fan fiction. Like, really, really bad fan. It was awful. It was awful, but well done awful. Like, it was, technically, it was well done. Actors are good. Like I said, set design was good. The music was great. I think the live performances with them, aside from Johnny Bravo on guitar, Entourage on guitar there, which took the realism right out of it. Like, yeah, Steve Jones is not that sensitive, articulate, you know, he's talking about his feelings and his dreams. And Steve, it's like, have you ever heard Steve Jones? That's not Steve, but they needed a guy to be that guy, to fill that role, so they'd have a story. It was their way in, was his book. They had no intention of really following the book. They didn't care about the book. It was just their hook, their way into the story, you know? Because they had to follow someone as almost like an in for, like, the audience, you know what I mean? So that they could come in on. And they just picked that guy. And, man, that took me out of it a lot. So, yeah, it's pretty awful. If you're a fan, watch it for a laugh. All these things are horrible, though. Anyway, the people worked really hard on it. You can tell. The actors are fine. But it was just goofy, silly, and unnecessary. And the whole part about trying to clean up the more subversive elements of the band was just sickening and embarrassing. And it just shows you where we're at in this day and age. And, you know, who's in control, really. And they probably got a lot of tax breaks for putting that kind of crap in the movie, because they do. You get money for I talked about in a video, like a few videos ago, about how there's federal grants that you get for the purposes of progressing society in meaningful, positive ways, which basically means adding the message to everything. That's why, you know, people that yell at like Marvel Comics or something about putting that stuff in their books, they don't care about selling comics at all because they've already been paid for. So it's just propaganda at this point. And a lot of that has to do with the Smith-Mund Act that was overturned in, I believe, 2012. It was overturned by Barry Satoro, wife of Big Mike. He overturned that, which basically was put in place. And it doesn't matter anyway, because these laws don't mean anything. It's just for show. It's just for us, so that we, the slaves, feel like there's a semblance of some kind of structured society. So I guess so we don't eat each other or something. So what he did, he overturned the Smith-Mund Act, which then said you could... It was there to keep news organizations and media from presenting propaganda as news. So that opened the door for these grants to come in. So that's why when you look at movies and stuff, posts about 2016, it takes a couple of years to put films and stuff into production. So 2016, all this craziness, message and everything started, to use the Critical Drinkers a little gimmick there. That's when it all started. And the timeline works out well. If it was overturned in 2012, these grants and programs probably came in soon after. And then from there, you know, stuff that went into 2016, that's when it started. That's when you had the Girl Ghostbusters. That's when Marvel Comics did All New, All Different. All this stuff came in, you know, the whole anti-white thing and all this stuff. But whatever, it's goofy, it's silly. But it seemed like they just wanted to refresh that brand somehow and be able to sell it. But in this day and age, trying to launch a whole new bunch of merchandise, all you need is one weirdo blue hair on Twitter to say something, and the whole thing could blow up and you could leave a lot of money on the table. So I feel that's a big part of it, you know? And there's probably a lot of other things. It wasn't done for love. It wasn't done for artistry. They got people on it, you know, who did put love and did put artistry into it, but ultimately it's like, you wouldn't do something like this. This isn't the kind of artistic endeavor that anyone, I mean, it would be tough for me to find any filmmaker to be like, you know what I'd really like to do? The story about my favorite, but it's like, no. There's always some other reason. You know, John Lydon probably knew that, and that's why they had to do the whole thing behind his back. But that's how it goes. And that's about it. It sucked. Watch it for a laugh. Or don't and be better off. Because it was hard to get through. Don't blame the teacher. Blame the school.